This is this first half is just is orchestrations I did. So orchestration, what that means is, like I said, I'll get a demo recording and the orchestrator chooses which instruments get assigned to which player. So do I want to have three saxophone players? Do I want to have one saxophone player? Which kind of saxophones? Do I want to have two trumpets, three trumpets with mutes? Do I want to have who plays where? Do I want to have the keyboard part be in the electric piano? Or do I want it to be in an acoustic piano? All those choices are made by the orchestrator. So, and sometimes the harmony, how it may be moving from a one chord to a four chord, but I might insert some interstitial harmony to bridge certain sections. So that's all, I have a lot of latitude in that. So this is a little group of, and you could see how much terrain I have to cover stylistically as far as, so these are some orchestrations I've done. They're just short clips all put together here.
Have you met any of the celebrities that you've written for?
Oh, yeah. I'm going to stop the share, but it doesn't matter. Yeah, I mean, how it is, I could meet any of them. It's really up to me, to be honest. They filmed the show in Kaufman Astoria Studios in Queens, and I live, it's really not convenient for me to be there. When I lived in Manhattan, I actually used to go to the set a lot more. So if I want to go, if there's a celebrity that I want to meet, I will go. And sometimes some of the celebrities actually, at once a year, the Sesame Street band plays a gig. There's a Sesame Street workshop gala, like a big formal dinner, and the Sesame band, we have a set band, we actually play live and back up the artists. So I get to meet them there too. So meeting the celebrities isn't so much my thing, but yeah, sometimes it's fun.
Okay.
For me, we have an 8-piece band. And obviously some of those were big band charts. Some of them were these more studio orchestra sounding. So obviously we do a lot of overdubs. We have one saxophone player, but the beauty is he could play everything. I mean, but at an excellent level, piccolo, flute, alto flute, all the saxophones. He even plays oboe, which is great. Then the trumpet player plays, he's our kazoo guy too, because sometimes we need kazoo. And I don't play tuba, but I play euphonium and bass trombone and tenor trombone. And then the guitar player plays electric, acoustic, banjo, ukulele, lap steel. And our bass player is wicked on upright electric. He's also a professional French horn player. And then our drummer plays vibraphone, xylophone, glockenspiel, all the mallets. So we can cover a ton of terrain with only 8 guys. So that's one of the luxuries. And sometimes to build a song, since we can't hire extra players, like that one Michael Bublé song, you know, with 4 trumpets, 4 trombones, I think just 4 saxes on that, you know, we have to just lay the tracks on one at a time. So it's a little time consuming, but at the end, the product's really good. So it's really fun for me to be able to kind of dabble in that the world with all the overdubs. One of the other things I do with Sesame Street, in some of the underscoring and kind of original underscoring that I do, is things called, that in TV and film are called sound-alikes. So we need some music that sounds almost exactly like James Bond theme, but it can't be, because there's actually a legal formula, how many notes could be just the same and how much the harmony could be. So you have to kind of skirt this line. So it's immediately recognizable as this other thing, but it's not exactly that thing. So one of my favorites, actually I have it here. We did a number of years ago, we were doing, actually here's the James Bond one. I'll show you this. And then this morphs into, this is one, because John's one of my heroes, but we did a spoof of Star Wars called Star S'mores. It was all Cookie Monster related. So it was all cookie puns and cookie jokes. So anyway, I think it's the first two. This is the James Bond sound alike. I'm sure you'll get it right away. And then the next one's the opening theme, the Star Wars. So that's that one. But then the Star Wars one is a bit longer. And this is, I was so psyched because John's one of my heroes too. Super Go. Oh, here it is. I got it. Here you go. This is your John Williams moment.
A long time ago, in a cookies and Milky Way galaxy, far, far away, Star S'mores. The thrilling story of a princess taken prisoner by the evil Galactic Empire.
Help! I've been taken prisoner by the evil Galactic Empire!
And of the unlikely heroes who must rescue her, there's the young Luke Pywalker.
I won't fail you, Princess Parthea.
The mischievous but lovable Flan Solo.
And don't forget, roguishly handsome.
With his loyal partner, Chewie the Cookie.
What? Whoa, 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 hey, whoa, stop the music! We can't have Cookie for partner.
Why not?
This why not? Cookie! Oh. Hey, not Chewie, Crunchy.
Run! You can't eat your partner. You'll have to control yourself or we'll never get to the princess.
All right. Anyway, I think that's pretty funny myself. I'm always a big fan of the Star S'mores stuff. So here, I'll give you a little window into what my life is like. So here's what this clip with no music. We'll just watch a little bit of it. This is the opening segment, what we call the title card when it first comes on here, Sesame Street. So this is, you can just watch a little bit of the title card. This is what they send me. And I get notes from Bill. We just watch this over and over again until we could figure out what, how to best move forward.
Does it come with notes? Do they usually have some sort of suggestion as to what they're looking for?
Sometimes yes, sometimes no. And after 10 plus seasons, they just pretty much give me a lot of latitude. If it's something they want really specifically, they will. All right, so this, it goes into something else here, but that's the end of the title card once we get to the When You Wish Upon a Pickle. So the trick is to make it sound, because to make music in film and TV to fit all these cuts that have different shots, it's very tricky and deceiving. So as I watch this, so we need music here for the pickle coming across the thing and the trucks driving around the world, and that's all nice and we're closing. And now as we cut to here, the zoom in, that has to be something different. And now as we're gonna get out of the room and cut to here, the zoom out, that has to be something different, but also kind of the same. Then the back of the truck rolls down. Now we're back to the original theme and we're in the street. So each of these things, and it's kind of obviously cut with really quick cuts, we have to kind of accentuate the action and make the music fit the different cuts. So that's the trick of it all. So in the end, I came up with this one little theme for the clarinet at the beginning. So here's that. So that's the little theme I'm going to bounce around in the early part. Once it gets to this mysterious pickle chips flying, see, this is the great kind of sentences you get to use when you work at Sesame Street. Anyway, I'll play a little bit for you. Now you know what this is. And then we'll go back and I'll show you some things within it. So here's what I came up with. There, it goes into the Sesame Street theme from there. But just to get all the elements for this, I mean, this is very unusual for what you do for TV. This is much more of a cinematic film kind of cue. I mean, but this one cue probably took 8 hours to get, which is really unusual. I usually have to write so much more music than that in a day, but this is just because the opening sequence is really important. In this particular case, it was pretty stressful. There was about, in a 60-minute episode, there was about 41 minutes of music, and we had about 3 weeks total to write it, to record it, to have it mixed and sent back to them, which is in film, it's typically, you get per minute of music, it's the average is 1 day. So if we had 41 minutes of music, they give you 40 days to get it all done. To do it in 21 was just, it's a little overbearing. But some TV is much more down and dirty, and the budgets are much smaller, so you have to kind of really get it out the door. I'll show you a bit, something I stole though. This is just studying John Williams over the years. Like, so I was mentioning these magical pickle chips. When Elmo hits the button here, right there. Okay, so you see these pickle chips flying around here. So John Williams, one of his tricks is to use chromatic scales up high in woodwinds, so it would sound like this. They're in tritones, not to get all technical. Some people are interested. So
we can't hear that, Joe.
Oh, you can't hear the piccolos?
There we go.
Great. So what that is tritones. They're a minor fifth apart, playing chromatically. And then what you do is surround them with some kind of keyboard that's playing also in parallel tritones, but they're playing whole tones. So it has this really ethereal quality, which sounds like this. So John Williams uses this, he's been using this move for years, but he used that kind of ethereal thing in like a lot of the Harry Potter music, for example. So if you just take out the rhythm section, the combination's this. So it's, as being this, one of the great things you could have as an orchestrator and arranger is stealing from everybody. Like, no one's going to call me out and say, I mean, those patterns aren't John Williams, but the whole flavor of it is straight from him, you know? And you just have to have an arsenal full of a lot of different things you stole. There's a great book out, and it was a New York Times bestseller. It's called something like Steal Like a Genius, or Steal Like a King, or Steal. And that's how all creativity is. I mean, like, people go all the way back. So anyway, oh, let me get... I think I might just have video. So I had to do three different versions in this Elmo the Musical segment. So this is the first one, and they called it Elegant. I know you saw a little bit of this before. Let me go full screen.
Tell Detective Elmo what happened.
Well, I was feeling glum and gloomy. My mood was down to my knees. So I ordered this bouquet, and then I started to sneeze, 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 sneeze.
Sing with Elmo this time to help him remember the tunes. Sneeze, 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 sneeze.
Sneezing hasn't stopped. I've no idea what to do. So I put down the bouquet, pick up the phone, and call a chew.
So that's the first. So then Elmo gets a tip, and he gets a tip and ends up at this guy's apartment.
It's your detective Elmo and his detective assistant. What's wrong?
I was feeling kind of hungry. I ordered pizza with cheese. But when the pizza got here, I started to sneeze.
You said sneeze.
The sneezing hasn't stopped. I couldn't figure what to do. So I dropped my pepperoni slice, grabbed the phone and called.
Achoo.
I gotta tell you, though, I'm still pretty hungry.
So, I mean, that's the exact same song, the exact same chord progression, everything, and you just have to reimagine it. And then the third one, then it goes to this more operetta vibe.
My old salt and pepper mustache became infested with fleas. So I ordered a replacement, then I started to sneeze.
In the hills with Detective Elmo. Here we go. Sneeze.
The sneezing hasn't stopped. I've no notion what to do. The critics in the house tonight. Can you just imagine how I chew?
So anyway, I think those kind of moments I'm really proud of. I mean, to come up with those and crank that out, I probably wrote all that in one day, you know, and we were in the studio the next day, and it's great. It turned out really well.
What is your favorite Sesame Street character?
Grover, hands down. Just because he's hilarious. I mean, he's just, I could watch Grover as an adult, and I'll show you this clip. I found this clip. Oh my God. Just his ad-libbing. I was on the set this day, and Grover, this is just like a 2-second clip. He's, they wanted Grover to, I know it's hard to hear maybe. They wanted Grover to introduce this crayon to Big Bird. So just that whole thing, I could watch that over and over again. I just think Grover's hilarious.
First of all, like where you can like find inspiration from starting from, like if you have to start from scratch.
Well, it's much easier than you know. It's because if you do it enough, there is no need for inspiration. It's what your job is. You sit down and just start writing. And when it's your job, and it's also, if I had an hour to sit down with you and show you some things of how I get started, it's much simpler. And the creative process is I'm digressing a bit, but just stay with me. It's always shrouded in this mysterious thing. And it's not nearly as mysterious as you make it sound to be. Like, for example, if I was stuck, which I'm at this point, I'm not stuck, I would think of some song I listened to early in the day, and there's a bass line that goes doom doom ding doom doom boom 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 doom, and I would just write that down. Okay, and so I'm already stealing that, but that just gives me a way into a song. So now I'm like, okay, but I wouldn't write that bass line instead of doom doom ding doom. I might go doo doom doom boom ding doom doom boom ding doom doom doom. But it gives me a starting place. Because as we all know, like once you have an idea, to edit something is much easier than getting something on the paper. So there's a million things to steal from and just to be inspired by. I don't even think twice. Whatever's in my head at the moment, it's really, because the speed of how I have to work, it's really a light called, not me, but anyone in this job, because the best first idea. I might just sit for 30 seconds, let something come in, and then I'm just off and running. And there's a great quote I always like to say. The great Frank Gehry, the architect, is one of my heroes. And I remember seeing him early in my career in an interview, and they were saying, how do you come up with all these find the creative solution to all these things and what's the inspiration. And he pauses and he looks at the interviewer and says, inspiration is for amateurs. And that's all he meant was, when it's your job, it's not as magical. Like, we don't, some magical thing doesn't float into my head, you know, like, so it's really, it's much more down and dirty and less glamorous than it sounds. I hope that answers your question.
You know,
it does, thank you.
What you say is, well, we had another speaker last week, Stephen Rosenhaus, who's also a composer, and he pretty much said about the exact same thing. You know, you get one or two sort of germs in your head that kind of, they're sort of, that's you. But then the rest of it is the craft. How do you put all of this stuff together to do what it is your job is? That's a really good way how you phrase that.
You're 100% right. I always called it, actually, it's building a song or building a musical cue. It's not composing in many ways. You have a little melody or a little motif, and it's really about constructing everything around it to make it fly. That's 100% it. And it's been that way forever, you know? And like I said, I think a lot of creative people like to keep it shrouded, to keep other people out of their way, but it's really just it's a more of a lunch pail kind of thing. Once you understand the building blocks.
As a performer, who have been your biggest musical influences?
Easy. As a trombone player, as a professional trombone player named Ray Anderson, he's my hero, hands down. He changed my life. I've told this story many times. I was in Pittsburgh listening to more classic jazz trombonist J.J. Johnson, Slide Hampton, Curtis Fuller, and I was driving home from a gig, and there used to be this nationally syndicated show called Jazz After Hours. I was out of Seattle, and something just wasn't resonating with me. But the DJ's name was Jim Wilkie, and he, at the end of a set of music, he would always announce everyone, not just whose record it was, every person on every cut that he played. So this trombone player comes on and I'm like, oh my God, this is how I want to play. This is my model and my way forward. And I actually pulled my car off to the side of the road so I wouldn't miss who it was. And it turned out it was this guy, Ray Anderson. And it's great. I mean, I've become friends with Ray over the years, and it's rewarding for me at my age now, kind of in my prime, and Ray's older, that people are like, referred to me in the press as like the torchbearer of like music of Ray Anderson. So it's like a huge compliment for me, but Ray's my hero.
What's your favorite ice cream flavor?
I don't eat sweets. It's weird. I'm a salty guy. It's not that I'm healthy. I could eat a whole bag of potato chips in one sitting, or pretzels. I'm not a sweets guy. Although as a kid, it was orange sherbet.